respect that. It's my pleasure to start the fourth panel, which brings us into the realm of judicial protests. We've talked about legislative protests just now in the case of India. And with our next speaker, who is Professor Kennedy Gastorn from the law faculty at the University of Dar es Salaam in Tanzania. We will be moving also looking at legislative and constitutional reform and the role of courts in the efforts of indigenous peoples of Tanzania to acquire rights for themselves and recognition, national recognition. Kennedy Gastorn is a very well-connected and well-known lawyer, especially in the realms of public law, constitutional law, commercial law, and international law in Tanzania. There's hardly an area that he doesn't touch. He's very much involved right now in judicial reform in Tanzania and a major, major donor effort to reform the judiciary. He's working here now in the U.S. He's a Fulbright scholar right now at State University of New York, Buffalo, where he's working on the East African regional bloc called the EAC, the East African Community, and how that is and isn't working. He is involved in trying to restart the production of law reports for Tanzania, which are a couple decades behind. He's on the National Environment Council. He's an advocate of the High Court of Tanzania. And he's also trying to build legal capacity by building more support for legal aid providers and producing more paralegals. So multiple range of efforts on his part to try to bring greater rationality, efficiency, and knowledge and capacity to the legal and judicial sectors in Tanzania. He holds a Bachelor of Laws and a Master of Laws from University of Dar es Salaam, and he's a doctor. He has a doctorate from the University of Bayreuth, Germany. So it will be a pleasure to welcome Dr. Kennedy. I also want to introduce my fellow discussant, Daniel Halberstam, who's one of our preeminent lawyers here in constitutional law here at the University of Michigan Law School. And then myself, Kelly Askew, Anthropology and African Studies, and I'll be the last discussant. So let me welcome Kennedy Gastorn.
Thank you very much, Professor Askew, for nice introduction. But more importantly, I would want to thank you on behalf of all other organizers for making this event reality, and also for extending an invitation for me to be here to talk about indigenous land rights in Tanzania. So my paper is about the state of indigenous land rights in Tanzania. And I thought I should talk about land rights not because I'm a land lawyer, but because really for many years if there is one among difficult issues that the government of Tanzania has been dealing with, and also the indigenous people in Tanzania have been really trying to achieve in terms of protecting it, is land. So land is very critical and central to all discussion about indigenous people in Tanzania. But more importantly, why am I interested to talk about land? It's because Tanzania does not have a policy, does not have any law which recognizes indigenous people. So basically, as a fact, from the government point of view, we don't have any indigenous peoples in Tanzania. Or, if you want, you can say every Tanzanian is indigenous. That's a position of the government. But there are two important initiatives that has happened recently, starting with the year 2011. In 2011, the government of Tanzania, under support of the World Bank, is developing something called Indigenous Policy. And it is a policy that's going to identify indigenous people for the purpose of supporting them under the umbrella of the World Bank. So as much as the government doesn't have any policy, doesn't have any law which recognizes the existence of indigenous people, but it is at the same time working with the World Bank to develop a criteria of identifying the people that are going to be to qualify as indigenous people for getting some economic support, a receipt letter. But the second initiative relates to the ongoing constitutional reform process in Tanzania. After 50 years of independence, the government of Tanzania thought that it is prudent now to come out with a new promising constitution which will help the government of Tanzania to move another 50 years. And in the draft constitution, which has just been issued in 2014, there is a provision which, to a large extent, try to recognize existence of indigenous people. Does not does that explicitly, but impliedly it does that. So I thought that it is something that I can share with you. Now, the concept of indigenous people in Tanzania, as far as land law is concerned, needs to be looked at historically. The first law, as far as land law is concerned in Tanzania, was enacted in the year 1895 by the then German colonial rule. That was the first law, land law, in Tanzania. In that piece of legislation, there was no recognition whatsoever of the concept of indigenous people. There was no concept of that. However, the German colonial rule tended to issue decrees that recognize tribal authorities and ethnic groups within the within the areas where where the people, colonized people, to accommodate their way of life, the custom and traditions. So in a way, you can say that as much as the German colonial rule had no policy or any law specifically mentioning indigenous people, still it accommodated some elements of tribal or ancestral land to some people in Tanzania. The German rule didn't survive much in Tanzania. It existed for a short period because immediate after World War I, the German rule surrendered the German East Africa, which was Tanganyika, which became Tanganyika under the British mandate. So the British rule immediately enacted another piece of law, namely land ordinance. This piece of law is very important. It's important because it is this piece of law that existed from 1923 up to 2001. So it survived independence. The most important point element in this land act, land ordinance of the British rule, was the fact that it introduced for the first time the new system of holding land, which is called right of occupancy. And that right of occupancy basically says that you have a right to own land, to occupy land, first of all, under the concept of right of occupancy, all land is public land, and all land belongs to the governor, and you can get grants from the governor. So that was the framework. But remember, during that time, we were not a colony. Tanzania was not a colony. It was a mandate territory. And one condition of a mandate territory was that interests of natives need to be preserved and need to be safeguarded. And that was the beginning of the concept of native. So for the first time, at least we had a certain provision which recognized the existence of natives. And we had a provision which recognized the not only the presence, but also the land tenure of the native people. And that land tenure became collected to be known as customary tenure. So from that time, we had two systems operating simultaneously. One, rights of occupancy that's granted by the governor, but also customary tenure, which is a tenure of native people, which is recognized by virtue of the British mandate in Tanzania. Now, that continued basically until independence. So as far as Tanzania is concerned, you had native and non-native. And native included everyone else except colonial administrators and settlers that came to settle in Tanzania. Now, so when we, in 1961, we got independence. The first thing that was done was, first of all, to define who is a native. And our definition of native was that a native is any national of African descent, including Somali, but including Swahili, but excluding Somali. Now, why was Swahili included but Somali not included? I'm not very sure. I really don't know why, but that was a definition. Until 1970, a native was any Tanzanian of African descent, including Swahili, but not Somali. In 1978, that definition was amended. A native was anyone who is of African descent, but not Asiatic or of European origin. So it was, we accommodated Somali and Swahili, but we excluded Asiatic and people of European origin. And those people of European origin and Asiatic origin were prohibited from accessing customary land. That means customary land was reserved to native, means any Tanzanians of African origin. That was a definition at independence, and that's a definition that continued basically until 1995. It is in 1995 when the government of Tanzania issued a new national land policy, which now abandoned the definition of native and non-native and introduced the concept of nationals or citizens and non-citizens. So today, we only have citizens and non-citizens as far as land ownership and land use is concerned. But more important is the initiative that took place immediately after independence, what I call is a national building process. In 1961, the government of Tanzania was very much interested to build a nation that is united, a nation that's not divided. And in that initiative, it thought that embracing the elements of ethnics, tribal, indigenousness, and so forth and so on, are divisive elements, and they should be prevented. So it was clearly stated that there should be no point, any reference whatsoever, as far as the government is concerned, for one to be identified with anything to do with religion, anything to do with tribal. It is on that note that in 1967, any mention of tribes, any censor based on tribe or religion were prohibited in Tanzania. So today, when you talk of there are X number of Muslim, there are X number of Christian, there are extra number of Maasai, that is not official statistics. Government does not have official statistics based on tribal, based on languages, as much as people would be able to identify themselves, because maybe it is people are able to identify themselves, but the government no longer collect any information regarding ethnicities or tribal or even religion. So that was initiative for building one nation. More importantly, tribal languages were immediately discouraged in Tanzania. In 1962, immediately Kiswahili was promoted as the only official language. That means today we have about 120 tribal languages, 120 plus, because nobody's sure of how many tribal languages are there again. But at least officially it is stated that we have 100 plus different languages. But all those languages, really vernacular languages, are not official, and the only official is Kiswahili. So Kiswahili was promoted as the only official language. That means, really, tribal languages as an element that can identify certain groups, certain individuals collectively as certain entity was again downplayed very much by the government. And immediately, again, the government moved to implement what it is called villagization program. The villagization program basically came under the umbrella of socialist policies, where people now were moved from original villages into new elected villages, basically. And it was purpose of the government to mix these people so that at least the stated objective was for the government to be able to provide better services for them. But in effect, certain groups really, in a way, lost their tribal, their cultural elements that were critical maybe to identify them. It is on that note that today, despite all those happened, or what happened, we still have communities that really are internationally recognized as indigenous people. And even the government knows it, that these are indigenous people. And basically we have four of them. That we have hunter and gatherers. And hunter and gatherer, there are two. One, Akie, which is estimated to be only 5,000 people, only 5,000 in 45 million Tanzanians, only 5,000 Akie. We have Hadzabe, which is estimated to be 1,000 only, 1,000 out of 45 million of Tanzania. We have pastoral groups like Barbeig, estimated to be 87,000, and Maasai, that are estimated to be around 450,000. So these four groups are very much recognized as indigenous people in Tanzania. They are recognized, and definitely they do identify themselves as indigenous people. They are somehow distinct from, really, very different from the mainstream Tanzanian. The mainstream Tanzanian. They are different from the so-called 100 plus, 120 plus languages. Now, in terms of land tenure, I need to emphasize two points. That in Tanzania, we don't have a tribal land. Tribal land is not a recognized category of land in Tanzania. We don't have a tribal authorities in Tanzania. Because in 1963, the first thing, among first things that were done by independent government was to abolish chiefdoms. So we don't have chiefdoms, which is very unique, different from many other African countries. All chiefs basically were absorbed in government, some sent to be ambassadors somewhere. So there was no tension, basically, because they were brought in the government, not excluded. And by including them in the government, these are tribal, chiefdoms were practically reduced, removed from being political entities in Tanzania. But the absence of category of tribal land, the absence of a category of traditional land, the absence of chiefdoms means even these indigenous communities remain powerless in defining themselves, remain powerless without having a good legal justification to make a case for their recognition. And whatever they have achieved, as far as land rights is concerned, is basically to claim on the basis of custom traditions, on the basis of customary tenure, without mentioning tribal, without mentioning traditional land, and without mentioning an aspect of indigenous. Now, despite all that, as I pointed out, in the year 2011, government came out with a policy framework on indigenous people. It's a framework that is sponsored by the World Bank. And as we speak, two communities in Tanzania, namely Hadzabe, the 5,000, and Barabeigi, the 1,000, have been initially recognized to be listed as indigenous people for the purpose of this framework. And this framework is designed really to support households from seasonal and unexpected shocks affecting their income and assets. So it is a poverty reduction strategy It is not entity recognition strategy. It is purely an economic empowerment strategy where those people are going to be identified and they are going to receive some handouts from government. Maybe I have not been, I'm not very much conversant with the American system, but I have heard something like food stamps. So maybe it is something like food stamps in American, in US system that's going to be implemented to support those people that will be identified as indigenous people. As to why the name, I don't know, but I asked one official at the TASAF, and he told me that it was necessary to describe it as indigenous framework to be able to access the funds from World Bank, because World Bank had a project for indigenous people. So you could not use anything, any other term other than indigenous. So there we are. We have that. We have that. But again, it is important to note that the government of Tanzania is one of the signatories to the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples of 2007, like India. We also have very much, we are signatory to that declarations. And when in the year 2013, when the constitutional reform process began in Tanzania, the government really received many comments in terms of indigenous people. But those comments came under the umbrella of minority rights. So the government accepted the concept of minority rights and immediately mentioned specifically in the report that Maasai people, Hadzabe, Aki people, and Barbaigi, these are minority and they should be protected. So we have a provision, Article 46, in the draft constitution, which says that the government shall put in place a legal procedure that will enable minority groups in a society, among others, to be allocated with land which traditionally the groups have been using for their livelihood and obtaining food. Now, the two initiatives, namely the World Bank supported TASAF and the new provision under the draft constitution, Article 46, which talks about minority rights. It seems to me like maybe that's a beginning of a bigger picture. And it seems to me like that's a slow recognition of the concept. Because again, the government of Tanzania has been very clear that it does not recognize anyone as indigenous, because by doing so, it will be creating classes among various tribal communities unnecessarily. They see no value of labeling some communities as indigenous and the other as non-indigenous. Politically, they don't want to do that. However, they are prepared to accommodate and facilitate and support some community that may, even when they may identify themselves as indigenous, but is still in the context of economic empowerment. And when I asked the commissioners in the draft constitution, they pointed out clearly that they have learned this from our neighbors, Kenya. Because in Kenya, there is the same provision, Article 46. Actually, it was copy and paste from the constitution of Kenya 2010. But Kenya has a different history. Because in Kenya, tribal authorities is an entity that is practically recognized in their constitution. We don't have that category in the constitution. Now, my thinking is that indigenous groups might be able to use these provisions as a basis to move ahead and maybe really have their recognition, have their rights protected. However, the Constitution does subject everything that promises to the ordinary laws, and that's a problem. Because the Constitution says subject to the laws that are going to be enacted by the Parliament. And we already have laws that are enacted by the Parliament, namely Land Act, which does not recognize anything about that. So that is again going to be another difficult because it would have been prudent for the Constitution to explicitly provide for those rights instead of subjecting those rights to the ordinary laws, which we know we already have them, and there will be no need of amending those provisions. I thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and thanks for inviting me to comment on this very interesting paper. I should say that I do constitutional law, comparative constitutional law, but I'm not a property rights expert, and I'm not an expert on Africa. My main area is the European Union and American constitutional law. So let me just say three things about this paper, actually. Let me introduce it by something to frame it, which is actually, which came out in Professor Gastorn's opening description of the history, is that in some ways what we're confronted with is a classic problem of equality. And you can kind of view sort of the French vision of equality, where everybody is declared to be equal, and then we don't recognize any individuality, versus a kind of substantive equality, where you actually look behind people's differently situated situations in order to give them what they need. And in some ways, actually, in the United States, we've actually shifted completely towards a formal level of equality as well in the U.S. Supreme Court, that the U.S. Supreme Court is against affirmative action, is against race-based measures, in part because it simply wants to declare everybody is equal, and therefore we're not going to actually look behind people's individually situatedness. And so in some ways you're struggling with the same problem, that there seems to have been this sort of the French equality of the 1960s came in and declared everybody to be equal, and now you're sort of actually ratcheting back towards a more substantive understanding of equality. So if we wanted to restore a substantive conception of equality, how could we do that? So first of all, you could look at political rights, right? What kinds of political rights, special political rights, could you give various groups? One of the things that I work on extensively is federalism. So of course, you could give people federalism rights, rights to autonomy. And this is sort of the big debate in the literature, whether you give them rights to autonomy, self-governance, or whether you give them rights to participation. So the debate between federalism and the other side is generally known as consociationalism. Do you give the groups rights to be involved at the center, or do you give them rights to determine themselves? And so the question here for Professor Gastorn is whether there's any hope to revive either one of these in a workable way. So is federalism workable? There are no tribal lands, no tribal authorities. So in some ways, the substrate of federalism seems to have been eliminated. But is there also possibly a deeper problem towards autonomy and self-governance in the sense that some of the tribes might not consider themselves regional geographic tribes? So that is often a problem, or could be a problem with federalism. If we look at consociationalism, we often run into other difficulties. The main one is, how do you decide what kinds of participatory rights minorities should receive? Should they get participatory rights that are proportionate to their population? In which case, that might not give them very much. If you're 2% of the population and you guarantee them 2% of the rights at the center, that doesn't give them very much. If you tell them, well, you're 2% of the population, but you're going to get a veto power, well, everybody else is going to start complaining. This is a famous problem in Canada, where the French Canadians view themselves as co-equal founders of Canada. So all the other provinces say, well, we should all have one vote. The French Canadian says we should have one vote, and all you Anglo provinces should have one vote because we are co-founders. And in some of what I read in your paper, I got the sense that some of these groups view themselves as kind of co-founders beyond their just proportional population. So that is something to be considered if you're trying to come up with a kind of consociational scheme, which I think in some ways, it seems to me that Tanzania is working towards. I don't think they're working towards federalism. They're trying to give more participation rights. So the question is, what are the limits of the participation rights you can give? The second thing we could talk about is civil rights. So what kind of civil rights can you give individuals? And there, I would be interested in learning more from you, and this is sort of my question, about the institutional mechanism for protecting these civil rights. Are we looking towards courts? Are we looking to courts to protect these, or are we looking to legislatures to protect these? Now, for example, in the United States, Section 5 of the 14th Amendment gives Congress special power to actually enforce the civil rights. So we have actually, part of our constitutional history has lodged the protection of civil rights in the legislature specifically. Obviously, our Supreme Court has done very much as well in certain times of our history, at other times not, but during certain times of our history to protect civil rights. The Indian Supreme Court has taken many principles of the Indian Constitution and just run with them and actually brought quite a bit of civil rights to individuals, especially including property rights, actually. To disenfranchise. It gave them rights to, it gave squatters rights to property, it gave individuals rights to vaccination, and so this, so the Supreme Court sort of took rights in the Constitution and ran with them. So the question is, are you looking to courts or to legislatures to enforce these? And if I were trying to state build in Tanzania, I might try to build a powerful court to try to put together the incentive structure to have a powerful court. That also depends on what the actual principles are that you are interpreting or applying. Are these soft law principles or hard law principles? By which we mean, are they judicially enforceable by their nature, or are they not judicially enforceable by their nature? And here, if I look through the provisions that I see mentioned in the piece, I see a lot of what looks like soft law ideas. The IPPF, actually, in addition to the food stamps program that you mentioned, it also seems to have some participatory rights. It says that, in fact, the policy framework will not be created absent participation rights by the affected groups. And so in these sorts of soft law measures, it's often good to have a small hard law component. So, for example, yes, you only have to listen to me and then do whatever you're going to do, but it's a legal requirement that you meet with me. And that legal requirement we can actually enforce through hard law. So even when you have these soft law, mushy requirements of listening to people or something like that, if you actually want to give them some bite, it's useful to have some hard law element of them that would actually allow you to get into court. And then Article 46, I mean, you read Article 46, and it's not clear to me whether this is a soft law or a hard law. The country authority shall put in place a legal procedure that will enable minority groups in a society to participate in leadership in, of the country authority, for example. So the country authority shall put in place, that sounds mandatory, a legal procedure. Well, that sounds pretty vague. It's not quite clear how a court could come in and say this is what needs to be done. Again, the Indian Supreme Court has actually taken some quite vague provisions and run with them. But if you're trying to get a court involved, the more specific the right is, the more the court will actually be able to adjudicate it. And so you have sort of this soft law, hard law question. Finally, and sort of most speculatively, let me just ask about the possible limits of the law or the limits of the situatedness of legal language. And by which I mean, can we recognize the rights that we want to recognize in the language that we need to use, or in the language that the law needs to use? What I mean by that is, when you're talking about rights that are emerging, you're talking about property rights that are emerging. And I'm wondering whether by calling them property rights and by analogizing them to, let's just say, Western-style property rights, whether we are doing violence to the self-conception of the indigenous peoples and how they would understand their property rights. And you could see that, for example, in Indian land rights quite easily. In a somewhat, I am again not an expert on Indian American Indian law, but as I understand it, Native Americans do not believe that they have property rights in their land. And yet the only way we, as the non-Native American legal system, can recognize their whatever it is relationship to the land is by giving them what we call property rights. But notice we've actually perverted their understanding, their self-understanding of what their relationship is to the land. And I'm wondering whether when I see hunter-gatherers and the pastoral groups here, whether by giving them Western-style property rights, we aren't sort of doing violence to their own self-understanding of their relationship to the land. And that just sort of suggests to me that there might be certain limits. Limits of the law. Again, not limits of the law if we were to start afresh from their perspective, but limits of the law as it is currently constructed, namely that the majority group is constructed according to Western style of law, and now once we give the minority group certain rights, we are giving them rights that we understand in a certain way that might actually not correspond to how they would understand those rights. So with those sort of three questions. Okay. Thank you very much.
I actually put a PowerPoint together, so let me...
Ah, sure. Should I move?
So let me just begin by saying that I had the opportunity to have a conversation with the former vice president for Africa at the World Bank, one of the most powerful people in the world with regard to Africa's fate. And we were talking about a major investment enterprise that has been launched recently under USAID, and it involves Monsanto, Cargill, Unilever, DuPont, General Mills, and its massive introduction of multinational agro-industry into Tanzania. And he says, I know there are problems. I don't need to hear all the problems. I know there are problems. What can I do to ameliorate? Or what would you say is some of the biggest problems? And I said, well, one of the problems is that by virtue of moving these people in, you're giving more cost to the government to move people out, namely pastoralists, hunter-gatherers, the people most vulnerable in their land rights. And I made the perhaps unfortunate choice to say it's affecting badly the indigenous populations. This former vice president of the World Bank was himself Senegalese. And he immediately jumped back and he says, I don't use that term as an African. We don't have indigenous peoples in Africa. So he has aligned himself to the Tanzanian official position that there is no more indigenous person in Tanzania. Maasai is no more indigenous than a Chaga person, a Sukuma person, et cetera. But he said, why don't they should be lobbying and mobilizing on the basis of being vulnerable groups. Now, given the choice, if you'd rather identify, self-identify as an indigenous person or a vulnerable person, I think it's obvious which one we would choose to identify as. So let me just move forward to say that at the time of independence in Tanzania, there was one national park, Serengeti. Oops. So you see at the top, Serengeti, most famous park in Tanzania. That was the only park at Tanzania, as Professor Gastorn mentions in his paper. Today, there are 16 national parks, and add to that forest reserves, add to that all kinds of wildlife game reserves, et cetera, et cetera. And so the land mass has shrunk considerably in terms of where people are allowed to live, cultivate, and pursue their livelihoods. Meanwhile, at independence, you had 9 million people in Tanzania. As Professor Gastorn says, you now have 45 million people in Tanzania, a five-fold increase. So you have land shrinking because so much of it's being given over to conservation and the population expanding exponentially. So whereas the 2009 figures are that reserve land, meaning all conservation land, was about 28% in 2009, I think that figure has grown by several percentage points ever since, and the village land, which is allowed for natives formerly up until 1995, has gone down. So there are two battlefronts that Professor Gastorn deals with in his paper. One is the representational politics, and secondly, the natural resource base. The history of indigenous mobilization in East Africa has seen similar transformations to the strategies that Professor Dahl described at the UN. In other words, people first began as natives under the German colonial period. They then were allowed to be identified by ethnic names, Maasai, Barabag, et cetera, et cetera, defined by language, culture, livelihood strategy, and territory. Now they have moved in the 1990s towards the term indigenous. They have formed NGOs that have the word indigenous in the name, and so they embrace that. But the strong backlash from the government stridently denying that there are any indigenous populations and the increased repression of efforts to mobilize under that banner has led indigenous groups in Tanzania to retreat from this name and now start focusing instead on being pastoralists and hunter-gatherers, because that is a little bit more acceptable to the government. As Professor Gastorn mentioned, Tanzania is famous for having built a nation out of 122 ethnic groups relatively successfully. It's an island of peace relatively compared to its neighbors, where mass violence and genocide, think Rwanda, Burundi, DRC, that are all immediate neighbors to Tanzania, have experienced. So the depoliticization of ethnicity, the refusal to allow the politicization of ethnicity is something that has started from early independence period, strengthened under socialism. Socialism now gave more ideological reason to suppress subnationalisms, and has continued on into the present. No censuses, as he said, on the basis of ethnicity. So alliances are being forged between indigenous groups in Tanzania and international groups at the UN and elsewhere, but these are cast by the government as unpatriotic and efforts to foment and re-energize ethnicity and tribalism, which for 50 years they have successfully managed to repress. So this becomes another rhetorical tool by the government to try to suppress political mobilization by indigenous peoples along indigenous lines. In the process that and negotiations in the courts and in the legal system that Professor Gastorn explores, we see that the new phrase of the day is minority groups. And so we see these semantic plays happening. Bruce Mannheim mentioned earlier that the Bolivian government simply read out indigeneity and wrote everyone is a peasant. In India, they embrace the term tribe for all the discredited use of that elsewhere. So now we have minority groups in Tanzania. But as he says in the written form of the paper, minorities seek equality with majority populations. They do not require communal self-identification. They do not embrace distinctiveness necessarily, nor do they have a particular relationship to a territory, and they don't typically have claims to priority and time. These are elements by which the indigenous term has tended to be defined. The newly added qualification clause to the draft constitution, so he mentioned the new constitution has this draft, at least there's language there that mentions minority rights within which indigenous groups can be subsumed. However, what he didn't say in the oral form, what he said in the written paper, was that these minority rights are to be protected, and there's a derogative clause that says, subject to present government resources and ability. So that would seem to abrogate any moral compunction to abide by international agreements on human rights, let alone indigenous rights. Rights that exist only when government coffers allow, rights that are subject to budgetary convenience, seem to my non-lawyerly mind not much of a right, a perversion perhaps of what constitutes a right, but correct me if I'm wrong. So the evictions that have been happening with ever-increasing number of pastoralists, especially from 2006 to 2013, and to add pain to injury, these are done in an especially violent way. They're done in the name of conservation a lot of time, as well as to make way for the new foreign investors arriving in town. But to give you just one stat, so here in 2006-07, we had 4,000 pastoralists evicted from an area that one of our colleagues in the room, Rie Odgaard, has long experience in, 320,000 livestock loss. So it's not just moving people off the land, but it's taking away from them the mode of their existence. And they collected $700 million, about $450,000 in fines. So this is what happens. They come into an area, they declare that you are illegal, they fine you for being illegal, they take away your cows, and then they force you to pay to get the cows back. They then use that money to bring in the police force to evict you. So you are underwriting your own eviction in the state of Tanzania. And this has been happening again and again. I could give you numerous cases of these evictions that are happening. So the reason why, some of the reasons why pastoralists and hunter-gatherer claims are especially vulnerable to eviction is that, number one, they are viewed derisively as nomads. They are viewed, therefore, as foreign immigrants. Well, if you're moving all around, perhaps you came from Kenya, you're not necessarily even a citizen. And remember, we moved to new language that citizens and non-citizens are the basis on which land rights are given. So you could be non-citizen. Secondly, nomads are supposed to have no permanent place of residence. So then you have no claim to any particular point of land. Thirdly, by not using land in the ways that the majority of people on the land, namely farmers, do, your use of the land gets called into question. Farmers have rows and rows and rows of very visible crops. It's very easy to see the use of farmers. But pastoralists use rotational grazing. They're here one day, they're there tomorrow. Hunter-gatherers, they leave no mark on the landscape. They're collecting things off of it in a way that maintains the landscape. So with use not visible, use is therefore less provable, which means your rights are at stake. Fourth, by not being valued as a high contributor to the GDP, which in fact is an absolute wrong, misrepresentation. It is estimated that traditional pastoralists contribute 40% of the agricultural GDP by way of meat and dairy products. Yet they are never attributed to being productive members of society. Instead, traditional pastoralism is always castigated as backward, archaic, not modern. We need modern cattle ranches, is the line of the government. And finally, as Gastron says in his paper, nomadism is associated wrongly and against all scientific evidence that it's associated with land degradation, pastoralists are accused of fomenting conflicts with farmers, that they spread animal diseases, and they are bad managers of the land, all of which become cause for evicting them from their land. Thus, indigeneity here in Tanzania, as elsewhere, becomes both a political debate over cultural inclusion and exclusion, namely the realm of representation in politics, and a battle over natural resources, land and water being foremost. Pastors are welcomed, indeed embraced, in purely cultural form. If we could just reduce them, I'm sorry, more on the evictions. Everyone, when you land in the airport, you will see images like this. Drive around Tanzania, you'll see images like that. So we love the Maasai for their cultural aestheticness and the attraction that they bring. A Land Rover ad here, they exotic backdrop to designer fashions, worse yet, Sports Illustrated swimsuit models, and of course tourists. They're a major draw for tourists. Without the Maasai, you might see a major drop in tourism. And now you bring Maasai to Zanzibar as security guards totally far away from their homeland, but they're now a necessary part of the Zanzibari experience, strangely enough, in a weird bricolage of modernity. And you can have these exotic weddings now with Maasai guards on a Zanzibar beach with a dhow in the background. So keeping them as cultural elements of Tanzania, and that alone seems to be what the government wants to do. I just wanted to say, as in a nod towards Sherry's wonderful paper, that cultural resources might be one method of helping to lay claims to land. There are recorded songs from the Maasai from the turn of the century that document their singing about the places in the landscape where they live, where they have brought their cows, and if those could be used as legal evidence, and I pose that as one question to you, for laying claim and proving rights to their land. My three questions to you are that you mentioned that there's this contradiction between the acceptance of the World Bank funds for indigenous projects, even as the government says, we have no indigenous people, we have no indigenous people. Fine, that's clear. But what isn't as clear is the fact that they're accepting the fact that their indigenous peoples need that support, that their indigenous peoples are teetering on disaster, that they are so economically impoverished that it would be wrong for them not to accept the World Bank money. So that acceptance that their indigenous peoples are marginalized, are very vulnerable, necessarily raises the question of why and how did they get there that way, and why isn't the government doing more? Does the government can't just say this is purely economic, we just want to, you know, help them, without addressing why they're there in the first place, it would seem to me. Secondly, what possibility exists for indigenous groups to contest this derogative clause you draw up about the draft constitution? Is there any hope of stripping that derogative clause so that rights aren't dependent on budget? And lastly, how does one fight against the growing number of laws that have been passed that effectively render pastoralism impossible? You know, by restricting the movement of animals across the landscape in the name of preventing disease transmission, et cetera, et cetera. Your own work has shown how many laws there are that make pastoralism effectively impossible. What can one do in that context? Thank you very much. Oh, you wanted that picture?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So thank you very much, discussants, for the nice comments, and certainly some of them are food for thought, so I'm very much going to read them once again and try to see how I can even improve more on my paper. But allow me to say that politics is, I don't know how should I define politics, but well, government does its things sometimes in a manner that is not coordinated, but sometimes in a manner that's coordinated, in a manner that is transparent, sometimes in a manner that is not that transparent. Honestly speaking, it's very difficult to gauge the proper, the logic why government should accept to craft a program, a World Bank-supported program for indigenous people, while at the same time it's refusing the existence of, I mean, using that label, that name, or that phrase, indigenous. But that's why I was thinking that maybe that could be a nice beginning, that this might be a seed for something good that might come, so that maybe more pressure can be done and more activists may work to achieve more because of already the government own admission through that. What are the possibilities of defending to remove derogative clause? But also, if I can connect to what Professor asked as to what kind of civil rights are we looking? Indigenous people do not have a person who is speaking for them politically. First of all, they are minority, and sometimes they don't vote. And even when they vote, they don't add a lot of value because they are few. So politically, they are not that much, I don't want to say important, but English is not my first language. I would wish to find another more diplomatic way of saying they can be ignored politically. They can ignore because they can't cause any problem. They are few numbers and that's the thing. So that's a problem we are having. And the only way that I see that can be used is court of law. Just go to court. And everything that has been achieved in Tanzania has been because of few cases that went to court and because of some good judgment that came out of the court. At least they shed some light to the rights of these indigenous people. So in terms of institutional mechanism, I think court of law is the only mechanism, if you ask me. I don't see the possibility in the parliament. By the way, the parliament, every decision is by vote. Now, vote if you don't have a lobby group. Here you have big companies wanting to go to stay in Maasai, in Ngorongoro, in whatever, in those nice, beautiful areas, which have been preserved by pastoral communities because they don't cut trees. Cultivators, tillers have cut all the trees, so they are creating deserts, so their areas are not attractive. You cannot have a strong lobby against those multinational companies that are coming. The only lobby you can get is in the court of law, because at least you are able to convince the minds and of judges and get a good judgment, not through votes in the parliament. So I'm skeptical in terms of using the parliament as a way to achieve their rights. And the government is very clear. Government policies are very clear that they no longer want nomadic or transhumant mode of pastoralism. They don't want it. Every pastoralism or pastoral communities are supposed to settle in their more or less permanent areas where they're going. And that's why we have a number of laws that restrict the movement of cattle from one area to another. But technically, these laws, we don't have a laws that prevent movement of cattle. We have laws that regulate movement of cattle. What does it mean? Nobody is prevented from moving from point A to point B, but we subject that movement to a lot of procedural requirement and authorization that you are supposed to get permissions and so forth and so on, and which, at the end of the day, it makes the movement impossible. Because where will you go to apply for a permit to move your cattle from Ann Arbor to whatever, Buffalo? I mean, you need almost three permissions from Ann Arbor municipal authorities to allow you to pass on, then another authority to allow to enter and exit, and you can't manage. And here you're talking about these humble pastoral communities that they just, you know, want to do good to their livestock and so forth and so on. So the government of Tanzania is extremely reluctant in supporting those pastoral movements. They don't want it. Now, you have shown some evictions. The government position, these are not evictions. Some of them are not evictions. Because the government policy is that people are even encouraged to move from there, you can settle at any place in Tanzania. So the government is saying, you Maasai people, because of your traditional way of livestock keeping, you are proud of having a lot of number of cattle, even when they are not bringing you any economic benefits. We have another place in Mbeya where, if you want, you can move your cattle there, because here it's already saturated. So the government is supporting them basically to move. But only to find that where they are moved, they are going to face another problem in the host communities, because they are going now to be treated as invaders, and they are going now to face a lot of problems, and they are going to be forced to come back. That's exactly what happened in Rufiji. People were moved from some part of Arusha to Rufiji. And the moment they arrived in Rufiji, people in Rufiji started organizing themselves, saying, wait a minute, why is government bringing these people here? And they started saying, no, if you come here, you can only have 3 cows. You can only have 10, no more than 10. So it's really a problem. So I really feel they are really having a hard time. No doubt about it. Now, in terms, how do you prevent these laws? I don't know. It is... I believe in court. Just go to court. The problem is that, again, really, these indigenous people don't have really people who are willing to argue their cases very well, litigate properly before the court. Most of the cases are done under pro bono arrangement. Lawyers are not paid. So sometimes we help them, but we are not properly engaged that we have to litigate their cases. So this is really a challenge, and I don't know how to do it, but I believe that activists, human rights activists specifically, are very much working with local communities and indigenous people themselves to work out on these issues, and hopefully there could be a possibility of revising some of the existing laws. Imaging Article 46, yes, the proviso which says subject to government. We have a lot of provisos in our constitution. Our constitution is full of provisos. Every right that's granted to human being, including right to life, is subject to not committing murder, is subject to not committing treason, because if you dare commit treason and murder, you'd be killed. So I'm not aware of any right in Tanzania that is not subject to some kind of proviso. So that's another challenge that really we are facing. But again, we are moving maybe into a right direction. If you take historically to see where we are coming from and where we are going, there is a light of hope, the way I look at it. Now, the emerging property rights, technically, customary tenure is a property. And customary tenure is a property guaranteed by the Constitution. So, I think the challenge is that what is provided in the law books is very different from what you might call living law, or what really people think is. That's a problem. But in terms of whether the customary tenure, a customary right is a property right. It is a property right under constitution, like any other, under the Western understanding of the term property. It is property. But it is a property that's not protected. It is a property that is simply declared. But there is no way you can enforce it. So it is more of declaration that is unenforceable. That's why I'm saying it's more political. On one hand, you are saying, this is your right. Like the way some politician will be saying that, you know, we don't want a right to recall. There was a discussion whether a member of parliament who is not performing should be recalled by his constituents. And they were saying, no, you don't have a right to call. You know, or you are, people are the source of power. So if we don't perform, you'll say no. But they are not giving you a mechanism of how you should say no, when no is no. So basically, they are giving you something that you cannot enforce. And that's a challenge that we are facing in Tanzania. In terms of federalism, there is no question of federalism, really, in Tanzania. And I think this is very contentious. Remember, we are the United Republic in a sense of we have Tanganyika and Zanzibar. And the federal question is among the critical and politically sensitive issue even to talk about, even between Zanzibar and Tanzania mainland. Once again, very much thank you for the comments.